Hello and welcome to another episode of the 100% Wild Podcast. I'm Mark Kenyon with Wired to Hunt. With me, as always, my trusty partner and co-host, Matt Drury. How's it going today, my friend?
I'm good, buddy. How are you?
Doing well. We're, as we were just talking about before we started recording, kind of in the hustle and bustle of the holidays.
That's right.
So good stuff, but kind of be busy too, which, you know, I guess that's the story of our whole hunting season, right? We're usually flying around and trying to pack and work around hunting, or maybe the other way. I don't know which way it is sometimes.
Or both. But, that's kind of like our job. So it's all in one. Yeah. But it's the weird part, like the hunting side outside of in our organization, outside of Mark, Terry, and Taylor. The hunting side is like the secondary thing that I get to do. So it's the business side. You try, there's year end stuff you got to get, you know, finalized. And I know you're probably in the same boat, sponsors and all that kind of stuff. Plus getting ready for the trade shows. Mm-hmm. You know, we're kind of getting all of our meetings lined up and, you know, we hit it pretty hard, especially at ATA. You know, we have ATA, which is in Indy this year, SHOT Show in Vegas as always. And then we go to NWTF's national convention in February down in Nashville. But ATA is just like crazy, crazy busy for us. And I'm sure you're in the same boat.
Yeah, it's chaos. This part of the season is probably my least favorite part when you have to deal with all that kind of stuff. Yeah. gotta be a business person again and not just a yuppie sitting in a tree.
Yeah, so. I pretty much drag Mark and Terry to the trade shows. And then once we get there, I drag them from meeting to meeting.
I've seen that literally happen too, so I know you're telling the truth.
But it's all good, you know, finishing some year-end stuff. We're going to have a potluck here at the studio on Friday. And the guys here are excited. Trevor Walker, he's my camera guy and one of our editors. He does a lot of, he's a hunter too, and he smokes a lot of his own meats and all that stuff. So he's going to take two roasts from my elk, and smoke those, get up early that morning and smoke them and bring them in. And I'm making elk, you know, ground up elk burger, putting it in chili, and then we'll have guys doing sliders and chicken nachos and all kinds of good stuff. So, and maybe a drink or two.
Just one or two.
Maybe. So it's gonna
sounds like fun.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So what about from a hunting standpoint? Have anything new on that side for you? Anything coming up on that front?
Well, I haven't been out myself since we talked last, just honestly because I have been focused on trying to catch up on all the stuff I should have been doing, you know, in November that I was not completely doing. So trying to catch up, get the year and stuff done. But Trevor actually went up and checked my cameras for me on Friday, and he was going up to try to kill a doe while he was up there with his bow. And he checked cameras. We still don't have much on the lease showing up buck-wise, but he sat there over some standing beans Friday afternoon, and we had a deer that I have several pictures of and some history with last year. He's 5.5. Last year, he had this abscess on his kind of like lower brisket, you know, I mean, really, really big, probably the size of not quite a soccer ball, but I mean, it was a big abscess. And this year, that's what stuck out to me last year. That's the only reason I remember him, honestly, because rack-wise, headgear-wise, there isn't a lot there. But this year, he showed back up, and he stood out to me from a frame standpoint. He's just tall. We call him Tall Boy. But, you know, he might score in the 20s, maybe touch 30. You know, he's an eight-pointer, doesn't have really much rack-wise, but he stands out from a kind of height of rack. And he showed up at 4 o'clock, like 4:08. He was the first deer on the field at like 80 yards the other night, you know, so on those beans. So Trevor ended up not taking a doe that night. He went back up there and killed one the following evening on kind of the lower part of the farm. He was sitting clover that night, and it was a warm night or whatever, and got a doe. But anyways, the plan is Missouri's muzzleloader season starts on Saturday. And, you know, with Christmas, it's like a 10-day season, but with Christmas, you know, and all the things that we have to do, I might actually be able to hunt 2 days, maybe three. So I'm going to try to, like, we have a major cold front coming through here this weekend. And Friday, I think it hits Friday. So I think Saturday I'm going to try to get out there and, you know, sit those beans. We got a good wind direction. We sat the spot we set it up. I paid the farmer to leave. Maybe there's maybe 2-3 acres of beans there. And we did it on the far end of my farm because in years past, we would do it in front of this box blind that we had. And the deer would never get there in time because it was just too far into the property. They would never, we could always see them. And in the late season, this big field and then the neighbor's field would suck in 30 or 40 deer, mostly does, but you know, maybe two or three bucks. And they would just never make it to us in time, whether I had standing corn or beans or whatever, they just never make it to us in time. Well, this year, Muddy, they have this new prototype blind that they're, I believe, coming out with in 2018. They wanted Mark to test it. He didn't have a spot open for it, and Dad had his accident. So they ended up sending it to me, and, you know, I'm like, oh, yeah, you know, raise your hand. I'll take it. So we set it up on this, on these beans, the way the farmer left them. It's kind of screwy. It's like a triangle. I wish it would have been more of a square or rectangular, you know, set of 2 acres that were left, but it's kind of in this triangle design. So we set the blind up kind of perfect for, realistically, if the deer come out, you know, once they cross the fence and if they come another 10, 20 yards, they're on our side, and they're early enough where I think, you know, the last half hour, maybe 45 minutes, we'll have plenty of time to try to get a shot. You got to fool a lot of does, noses to get to that point, but I think if we hunt smart on the right wind, I think if he shows up, we actually have a pretty good chance at him. So, you know, I don't really care about the score, obviously, as every deer I've ever shot is probably about 130 inches, but I really don't care. He's mature. And to me at this point, it's about proving, you know, that I can do it. I've worked so hard, Trevor and I have worked so hard, and Aaron Bennett and the guys in the past, and we're just not being successful on this place. And it's not because we don't have the right setup or that we're not hunting it the right way. It's just like the way the chips have fallen kind of thing, yeah, which we talked about that last week. And so I kind of have it up, you know, under my skin that I'm after, you know, a good management buck to, you know, try to take off that place. And if I can get another shot, you know, I have a doe tag too, that I'll try to kill a doe while I'm there as well, especially if I get lucky and shoot a buck, you know, and we're still out there and have another chance. I'll try to kill a doe, and, you know, we got some good share the harvest programs and all that good stuff. So I'll make sure and donate the meat and all that good stuff, because I'm definitely covered on meat for the year. But we got so many deer there, mostly does. We need to do a little management, honestly.
Yeah, that'd be a heck of an accomplishment to kill a 5-year-old out there. I think that'd be awesome. So I'm excited to see how it goes. Keep me posted.
Our next podcast, you'll be like, "What happened?" I'll be like, "Nothing." That's the way it seems to go.
Yeah.
How'd Ohio go? Eventually. Yeah. How'd Ohio go for you?
You know, as usual. Was there for 3 days. Didn't see much. Shot one night. I saw 1-year-and-a-half-old buck. The second night, I saw a bunch of deer, including 6 or 7 bucks, but they're all young ones, year old or 2 year olds. And then the next day I didn't see anything at all. So pretty slow, kind of warm, is what it is. So I'm back home and in no sight of Holyfield, no pictures, no nothing. So I'm about to switch gears probably in the next few days and start focusing on killing some does on that property, just to, similar to what you said, this property specifically just has a lot of does. It really needs to be kind of managed on that front. So I've been pushing it back, trying to kill this buck. But at some point, I just have to kind of say, you know what, it's time to be a manager now and not be so focused on trying to kill this one deer, if he's even still out there. I don't even know if he is. So, yeah, I think the final like 10 days of the season are going to be trying to put some meat in the freezer and make a dent in the doe population. Yeah. So that's... that's basically all I've got. All the news on my front.
We're in the same boat, frankly. It sounds like.
Yeah. So I'm excited to hopefully.
Is the boat sinking though?
Yeah. It is kind of fun though, once you start shifting your focus to just targeting does. You know, all of a sudden it becomes a very target rich environment. Yeah. And that's a fun different part of the season too. So I am excited for that. And then it'll be on to next year and new hopes and dreams and possibilities and all sorts of optimism again. So
start all over again.
Yeah. So I'm excited for that.
Good.
But speaking of next season and postseason. We have a question of the day today from a listener that's related to that and how trail cameras kind of fit into some postseason thoughts. So I was thinking this would be a good one for us to tackle today. And if you're ready, I say we should tackle that question of the day.
Let's do it. The question of the day is brought to you by Cabela's, the world's foremost outfitter.
Hey, this is Jason from Somerset, Ohio, and I've got a question concerning running trail cameras on small tracts of land in the off season. I'm talking between 5 and 20 acre lands, and especially if it's, you know, in areas that's surrounded by other small pieces of land. And the reason why that's relevant is, you know, those smaller tracts of land are going to have more human intrusion in the off season than say 500 acre tract of land that, you know, people are only in there when they're hunting. I'd like to know if it's better to leave those cameras up in the off season, you know, just to let the deer continue to be used to them, or if there's benefit to pulling them out and then putting them back up in, you know, August, September, things like that, and let them run through the deer season. Thanks for your time, and I look forward to the answer.
All right, Matt, what do you think?
I think he's got a valid, it's a valid question. The thought process I would have, if it's that small of a piece, I'd be a little worried, not knowing, you know, what his neighbors are like or what the area is like. I'd be a little worried about leaving a camera on 15 or 20 acres all year, personally. So I think I would pull them, because I don't think, honestly, it's going to hurt that much if you come back in July, you know, and you set a camera back up, especially, say, for instance, say you're in a state where it's legal to, you know, put some feed or supplement feed or whatever down in the summer months. You know, you put that out, and if you go in there to put your camera on, those deer don't care. They'll be on top of it no matter what. Now, if it's a state like Illinois or somewhere where you can't do that, I would just be careful about what time of day and when I would go back in there to put the camera back up. And then, like you said, just kind of leave it go until he needs to go in and check it every once in a while. But 15 or 20 acres, you definitely could do a lot of damage if you're not smart about your access or smart about the timing, wind direction when you go in there to go check the camera. But I would pull him personally. That's what I would do.
And you were saying I think what you're saying there a second ago is you were worried about like theft too, as a possibility.
You know, heck, on my lease, I had two cameras stolen, you know, and after that, I was very careful as to where I put them. And then if I did put them down kind of closer to where, you know, the access points were, I had them in lock boxes and stuff like that, just because, you know, I know it could happen again at any time, but I was trying to make it less easy for somebody to steal it. And in my opinion, I think it was somebody in their shed poaching, and then ended up getting caught on camera, and he's like, all right, I'm just taking the camera.
Yeah. I've had that happen too. And I would say, a couple things. I definitely can relate to your concern there from a theft standpoint, and that does, you know, could be more likely when you've got small properties and a bunch more people likely around on the edges, you know.
Yeah.
So to your point, I think if you're gonna keep them out, and if you know sometimes you know an area and you know your neighbors and you know that's not a concern, well, okay, then don't worry about it. But if you don't know the area as well, or you don't know what might be happening in the off season, to your point, I think lock it up. Keep it as secure as you possibly can. Maybe don't have it right out in the wide open. But I personally, even on my small properties, I like to run them in the postseason for at least a little while for two reasons. Number one, I really want to have cameras out there running for at least a few weeks after the season just to find out what bucks survived the hunting season. I really want to know what deer are still alive going into the new year, which deer I might be, you know, seeing again the following season. That just helps to kind of start making that plan for the new year. It kind of helps you as you plan on where should I focus my scouting, what should I be thinking about. You know, if you know that buck A survived and you happen to have a bunch of intel from him the previous year, now all of a sudden you can start thinking through, you know, and a lot of times what I like to do in February or March is think about all those things, plan strategies, already start daydreaming about where I want new stands, how I should do things different, et cetera, et cetera. So having cameras running in the postseason, at least for that maybe month or something after the year, is nice to get that. And then secondly, the other thing I really like to keep cameras running the postseason for in the early postseason is shed scouting. So I shed hunt all the properties I can hunt as much as possible. And one of the things that I recommend keeping in mind is that you don't want to get in there and shed hunt too early. You don't want to pressure these deer off your farm because you're going in there every few days to look for sheds when they may not even be shedding or even close to shedding their antlers yet. So if you've got, let's say, a couple bucks that live on your little property, if you stay out of there completely and wait until maybe mid-March or something when it's very likely they will have dropped their antlers by then, you know, at that point there's a good chance that those deer, if they've been sticking close to your property, that they'll drop their antlers on your property or nearby, let's say. But if you go in there every week and walk all over all the bedding cover, if you spook those deer out there every few days or every week, then it's, you know, it's quite possible they're going to relocate to your neighbor or somewhere else or whatever it might be. And then you never have a chance to find those antlers at all. So
relocate for good too, honestly.
That too. So I like to try to time my shed hunting based on some scouting. So I take, you know, historical data just based off what we've seen in the past. And then also I'll try to keep cameras out and monitor the deer and not start really shed hunting until the majority of bucks have shed their antlers. So that can just help you time, because you want to make sure you don't go too early for the reasons I just described. But at the same time, you don't want to go too late because you could have antlers getting chewed up by squirrels and other rodents. Or you could get, you know, like you mentioned earlier, the potential for shed poachers, people to come walk your property and steal those antlers. So it's, you got to find that sweet spot where it's not too early, not too late. And I think having some cameras out can help you do that. But I think to your point, keep them secure. And then you also mentioned, and I 100% agree, you got to be careful still about going in to check those cameras. Because again, you don't want to blow these deer off your property, make them relocate. And that could be, you know, that could even impact your hunting season the next year. It could impact your shed hunting this year, et cetera, et cetera. So I would say try not to go in, you know, be almost as careful as you are during the hunting season, even in the postseason. So go in there at midday, you know, take a truck or an ATV or something like that if you can. Don't go busting through bedding areas. Don't go blowing your wind into bedding areas. All those kind of basic things that we try to do in September and October and November. If you can apply that same caution in the off season, that's only going to help you. So that's kind of my two cents. I do usually pull my cameras after shed season. You know, once it gets to mid-March, I usually do pull them and keep them in the house for a couple months, and then I start running them again in like July. I know some people that keep the cameras out all year round. I just don't simply be – I don't really have a good reason for why. I just pull them in for a while, kind of get them cleaned up, re-batteried, ready to go again, and then I approach things, you know, for the new year after that.
Same here. I mean, I'll go through – like you said, I'll wait until shed season. And the other reason I do that, because in Missouri, you can, at least in the county I'm in, you can still supplemental feed as of today. They might change that tomorrow. But I'll, like this year, I did it a little bit last year and the year before, where like February or March, I put out some analogics. But this year, I think I'm actually going to start a feeding program, you know, come end of January when I get back from the trade shows and put a feeder up and get those deer kind of sucked back down into the property. You know, and then, cause I don't really find a lot of sheds during shed season, you know, a handful, and it's hard to find. And well, they're hard to find regardless, but it's just what I do find. It's usually like 2 year olds or 3 year olds at the max. Very rarely do we find a good shed. And I just don't think they live on me. I think I have a ton of does living on us and not many bucks at all unless they're young. So my thought process this year is, okay, instead of starting a feeding program in July when it's really too late for antler development anyways, for the most part, Why not try it when they say that, you know, they say as soon as they drop, they're already starting, you know, to develop for the following year, so, or for the following season. So my thought process this year is to try the program right out of the gate and see how we do there, you know. And I don't know. It's one thing to say that, but it gets so crazy during that time of year. I'll have to go out and execute the plan. But that's what I'm thinking about doing this year, because I, for a few reasons, try to help antler growth development for 2018. you know, when they first start and when it's the most important, because I hear a lot of times that March, you know, March, April, May is when it's super important. So to try to help affect that, and then to try to suck some deer back into the place, some bucks back into the place, for shed hunting purposes. So we'll see. But that's the plan anyways. But I'll leave my cameras up through that period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and to your point that, you know, late winter time period is one of the greatest stress periods for deer in general from a nutrition standpoint. There's just so little left over at that point that, you know, if you have a nutrition, you know, system that you can put in place, that can be helpful.
Yeah.
And then to another, back to the shed hunting scouting thing I was mentioning earlier, back to going in to do postseason work and different things. One, you know, the postseason is a great time to scout. It's a great time to do that kind of stuff. Of course, it's a great time to shed hunt. But it also is, you do need to be careful, I think, especially if you're in an area where you've had a really, really tough winter. You know, that is also the time when deer are the most susceptible to starvation and other stresses from just dealing with that long, hard winter. So you want to avoid causing them to use unnecessary energy as much as possible, yeah, too. So, you know, you kind of want to think about those things. Think about, you know, trying to time your intrusions to be as minimal as possible. If you're going to go and do some shed hunting and scouting, maybe say, okay, I'm going to do it on these 2 days and then I'm going to leave them alone for the next, you know, 2-3 weeks or whatever, simply because sometimes when you have a tough enough winter or a situation where there's so little food for whatever reason, these deer can really struggle in February, March, even into April, depending on where you're at. So that's just something to keep in the back of your mind too, as you're thinking through all your different postseason plans. Of course, there's lots to do in the postseason, but sometimes thinking about how can I balance it a little bit to just make sure I'm not making things tougher on the deer, that's something to think about.
Absolutely.
So, I don't know. Do you have any other thoughts on postseason trail camera use? I feel like, you know, kind of through this conversation, we've touched on a bunch of the things that I wanted to. Anything else?
I think it depends on your property, like you said. Like, I know Terry will leave his cameras up year-round for the most part. And he likes to keep kind of a herd inventory. Mark, he has a lot of cameras, so he'll pull them, he'll pull them in the winter and put them back out like July once they, you know, the deer are kind of starting to be what they're going to be. So it's just kind of a different philosophy. But, it's really probably dependent on your property and your neighbors and, you know, kind of what you can trust. Because I just don't trust it, frankly. More than anything, I just don't trust it.
Yeah. It's a bummer that has to be the case, but and many times it is.
Yeah.
So, I did I ever tell you my Cabela's trail camera story?
Huh.
I'll give the very, very short version of it because people have heard it, I'm sure, on some of my other past podcasts. But I had a camera stolen off a small property I was hunting. I had etched my name and phone number in the back of it, though. Just, like, carved it into the plastic. Well, so it got stolen. I was really upset. And maybe like a month later, I get a phone call from somebody from the local Cabela's store asking me what my name was. I'm like, well, my name's Mark Kenyon. I'm like, all right, Mark, well, we've got your trail camera. The person that stole it from me brought it back to Cabela's and returned it and got money from it. And then they didn't see the etching on it or anything until like the next week or some period down the line. They saw, oh, this is somebody else's camera that was probably stolen. And so, yeah, they called me, and then I ended up getting it back.
Oh, my gosh. I mean, got to have a big set on you to just go in and return a trail camera that you stole. And
I know.
That's pretty ballsy, honestly.
It was, yeah. But I guess it worked out okay for me.
That's awesome. That's good customer service.
Yeah, that was cool. You know, they definitely didn't need to do that, so that was nice.
Smart of you to do that, though, because otherwise they wouldn't know. You know, I mean, that's smart. I would have never thought to etch my number into the trail camera, but that's a good thinking.
It was a lesson learned from my grandpa. He used to carve his name into, like, everything he owned. I'll tell everything from, like, chairs to coolers to a pair of gloves to everything.
Smart.
That name on everything.
That's smart. There's no mistaking it.
Yep. So there you go. I think that's a good way to end off our podcast on postseason trail cameras. Carve your name in that son of a gun.
Yeah.
And lock it up if you need to.
Tip of the day.
Yep. There you go. So, okay. Well, I think that's everything for me, Matt. So Should we shut this down?
Yeah, let's do it. I just remind everybody that we probably will not have a podcast up over Christmas break. And then that first week in January, I think we probably would be able to do it. But then there's like the ATA show, and then there, I think there's nothing for a week, and then SHOT Show after that. So it may be a little sporadic. We'll try to do our best and maybe pre-record something if we need to. But we talked about actually potentially trying to do something at ATA. It's so hectic, I don't know if we'll be able to, but yeah, we did mention trying to potentially do that. So just bear with us through the next couple of weeks, and we'll try to keep pumping out some good content.
Yeah, and until next time, to everyone, have a very Merry Christmas, great holiday season. Eat lots of venison, hopefully. Maybe put down a late season deer too. That's what I'm gonna try to do. And I guess I will leave with our final usual reminders from me, simply being to subscribe on iTunes or Google Play or Stitcher or wherever you get your podcasts. And then you can send in a question for future episodes by going to wiredtohunt.com/100%wild.
As always, you can watch this version of the podcast over at the Drury Outdoors YouTube channel. While you're there, please subscribe if you don't mind. We're doing a giveaway. We're giving away a free PSE bow. We're shooting for 100,000 subscriptions. I think we're at like 54,000 or 55,000, but when we started, we were in the upper 30s maybe. So it's awesome to see everybody kind of engage into the campaign. But we have a ton of content, some really good stuff. At the beginning of the year, I said, you know, follow along. We're going to have a ton of stuff we're doing that we've never done before. And I feel like we delivered on our promise. And hopefully 18's even better. So make sure and check us out on YouTube. And as always, you can follow along everything we're doing over at our social channels at Drury Outdoors. So thank you very much. Thanks for listening and watching more than anything. And I hope everybody has a safe and merry Christmas and Happy New Year's.
I will just echo everything you just said, Matt. Thank you, everyone. Have a great holiday.
Peace.